Being 6:30, I'll call the January 18th, 2017 Board of Selectmen meeting to order. Mr. Irwin, do we have a need for non-public?
I don't have anything except there's a couple sets of non-public meeting minutes to review that you can do this evening or some other time if you want to defer it.
Some other time sounds very nice.
Yeah.
That way we can proceed.
We have meeting minutes from January 4th. Any corrections to those?
No, I don't. I'm fine. Look at me. Would you like a motion to accept them as written?
Yes.
So moved.
I'll second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? We have two public hearings tonight. The first public hearing is a temporary outdoor event permit, First Congregational Church of Wolfeboro, UCC, to hold Easter Sunrise Service on April 16, 2017, from 5 a.m. to 6:30 a.m. at Albee Beach.
Hi. Good afternoon. Good evening, I guess. My name is Mike Turner. I'm representing the First Congregational Church of Wolfeboro. This is an event that we've had for several years, and we would like a temporary outdoor event permit for this Easter service on April the 16th at Albee Beach. Is what we requested.
Okay, I'll open the public hearing. Is there any comments from anyone in the audience? Seeing none, I'll close the hearing. Board members?
Yes, I have one. I was looking in the back. Your insurance policy is expiring, and you just need to give us the updated one.
Okay, we'll do that. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's already underway, but yeah, we'll be sure to update that form.
Okay, thank you.
Entertain a motion to...
I'll make a motion to approve the issuance of a temporary outdoor event permit for the First Congregational Church of Wolfeboro, UCC, to hold Easter Sunrise Service on April 16, 2017, from 5 to 6:30 a.m. at Albee Beach.
I'll second that.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The second public hearing is the First Congregational Church of Wolfeboro, UCC, to hold morning worship services from June 1st through September 30th, 2017, Sundays only, from 7:30 a.m. to 8:15 at Kate Park.
Yes, sir. We've used this, held these services for a number of years, and it's been great for, you know, a lot of tourists to come and join, and we have anywhere from 50 to 80 people every Sunday at that service. So obviously if it rains, not quite that many, but we would like to continue those Sunday morning services this coming summer, Sundays only, obviously.
Excellent. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone else from the public that would like to speak about this? I'll close the public hearing. Board members?
Only thing, the same thing with the certificate, but you bring one, it'll take care of two.
Yep.
Great. I'll entertain a motion at this time.
I'll move to approve the issuance of a temporary outdoor event permit to the First Congregational Church of Wolfeboro, UCC, to hold morning worship services from June 1 through September 30, 2017, Sundays only, from 7:30 to 8:15 a.m. at Kate Park.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next item is the bulk vote, which includes the weekly manifest, property tax abatement refunds, property tax credits and exemptions, notices of intent to cut, yield tax levy warrant, and grants less than $10,000. I'll entertain a motion to accept the bulk vote.
So move.
I'll second.
Motion's been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Appointments.
Yes, Mr. Chair. The Lakes Region Planning Commission has asked the town to fill the vacancy on the Lakes Region Planning Commission that was due to Chuck Storm's term expiring. And so we put the question to the planning board, as they're supposed to recommend candidates to the Lakes Region Planning Commission, and they put forward the name of their new town planner, Matt Sullivan, to be one of the town's two representatives there. So that's the recommendation, and it's a four-year appointment.
Any other comments from the board?
I think it's a good idea.
Sounds good to me.
I'll make a motion to approve the appointment of Matt Sullivan as a commissioner for the Lakes Region Planning Commission for a term through May 31st, 2020.
I'll second that.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion from the board? Seeing none, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Under new business, we have use of the Cape Park for a wedding. Is there someone here to speak to it?
Hi. On June 10th, 2017, I'd like to
use... Can you state your name for the record?
Oh, sorry. Laura DiTilio. June 10th, 2017, I'd like to use Cape Park for my wedding ceremony. It will hold 45 people. I'm hoping to have a jazz band included as part of the ceremony.
Board, have any questions?
No, the only thing comment I make is to you realize that the park will still be open. People can be coming through.
Yep.
Other than that, hope you have good weather.
Thank you.
I entertain a motion this time for the use of the Cape Park.
I'll make a motion to approve the application of Laura DiTilio to use Cape Park in the Wolfeboro Community Bandstand for her wedding on June 20, 2017, from 3:30 to 4:30 p.m.
June 10th.
June 10.
June 10th, sorry.
Thank you.
I'll sit.
Okay, the motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion from the board? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Next, we'll have a monthly budget expenditure report. Pete?
Good evening, Pete Chamberlain, Finance Director. At this time of the year, obviously, 100% is the maximum you want to see things at. I will say that there are a few things I still need to do to the budget, as usual, as I need to accrue salaries, and I had put a note in there telling you the gross amount of accrued salaries, in estimated anyway. And there are quite a few other adjustments that are going to happen over the next couple of months in preparation for the audit. So the general fund, as of this date, was at approximately 94-95%. Water at around 94, electric at 92. We had a good year in the electric department. The sewer fund is about 97%. And Pop Whalen is a little bit over this year at 102. And with an average overall expended to date of 94%. I also gave you an updated revenue report as promised. And when you, if you look at that, it's looking pretty good. I was surprised that the enterprise funds continue to get a little bit better every year. It wasn't that long ago when sewer was in a deficit every year. So, but it looks, those are sales numbers there that you see in the enterprise funds. So if you compare the budget to the sales, we seem to be marking a little bit over. Did anybody have any questions on the expenditure report?
I have one. I was looking, it looks like we have a surplus of about $1.4 million at this particular time. How much do you think those adjustments will be about? What do we adjust? Yeah.
I really don't.
You have no idea at all?
No, I don't really have a feel for it right now.
Okay.
I know there's 100, like I said, there's around $184,000 in payroll that gets...
So there's a good chance we could have a surplus around $1 million if we're 1.4 now? Not that good. I'm wishing.
There's a lot of accounts payable
are there?
Sitting
okay.
out there.
Okay, all right. Then I'll...
And accounts payables can be in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. They dribble in over a couple of month period.
Will you give us an update at some point? That would be great.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
I just had one question on the revenue sheet. The Parks and Rec income?
I saw that too.
Uh-huh.
45.49%.
Yeah, I overestimated that when I had there was an audit adjustment and it slipped by me that lowered when I was looking at the detail, it had some Pop Whalen money in there.
Okay.
So once you adjusted for that, there's a lot of movement that goes on at the end of the year between the recreation revolving account, the Pop Whalen fund, and things tend to get, when they get done, get adjusted in or out of Parks and Rec revenue because that's due to the nature of the way money is deposited with the billings and collections department. So that'll change. It may go up.
Questions from the board?
But I will send out an update just as soon as it gets to the point of where it's gelling, shall we say. And
I'd be curious to what the surplus will be.
Yeah.
That's an important piece because that then gets applied to the tax rate.
Yeah, if you're looking at, does the surplus you were looking at include the electric fund?
I was looking at the bottom line.
Yeah, yes. It's about $500,000 maybe in the...
Okay. It just looks so good. I was just hoping that was the case.
a lot of that is in the electric fund. I forgot what we've got in the general fund. Let me just take a peek. We got all right. So, yeah, that general fund's going to have some in there, but it's going to that'll creep down. There's a lot of bills that aren't involved in purchase orders, like electrical bills. Fuel bills,
okay.
Numbers of things. So,
thanks, Pete. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next, we have the amendments to the guidelines for the administration of the Josiah Brown Scholarship Fund. Mr. Owen?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. As the board will recall, at your last meeting, the board awarded a number of scholarships from the Josiah W. Brown Scholarship Fund, and it was noted at that time that the guidelines needed to be updated for a couple reasons. One, we've been giving out $1,500 scholarships as opposed to $1,000, as the guidelines state, for the last few rounds. And also, we had the situation of a part-time student as opposed to all the others being full-time students. So we were distinguishing here how those two different groups can be treated. And then I also took it upon myself to make a little adjustment to the income guidelines as it's been a few years since those have been adjusted. So I bumped those up just a little bit, as you'll see. So if those changes are agreeable, I would ask for the board's approval.
I have a question. Did you look at any of the applications that we saw and that we've had and that bump up? Would that have affected any of them?
A couple of them are very close, so this gives a little more leeway. So.
Any other questions on this? We're good then. I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the proposed revisions to the guidelines for the administration of the Josiah W. Brown Scholarship Funds.
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Any other discussion on this? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? David, do you think this is too low of a figure?
Well, that was $5,000 higher than what it was before.
So we'll be discussing the application of the Wolfeboro Property Holdings LLC for tax relief incentives. Mr. Owen?
Oh, this is the property tax incentive? Okay, the board held the public hearing on this, and then drafted a decision for the board's consideration. There's a 45-day period, but I didn't feel there was any need to wait the full 45 days. So, and I had town council review it, and I've incorporated his review comments in the decision, and I think it's ready to go unless there's any changes that the board wants.
I'm fine with it. I thought it looked good and covered what needed to be covered, and a good template for us to do other ones if that so happens. So we need a vote on this, Mr. Owen?
Yeah, you need to vote on it and sign it.
Okay.
And there's one step remaining, and that is that the property owner and the town need to enter into a covenant agreement.
Yeah.
To ensure that the public benefits that are being derived from the project will be kept in place for the duration of the tax relief that's being provided. And town council is going to draft that covenant agreement, and I'll bring that forward when it's ready.
And just for the people in the audience, it's up to 5 years.
Correct.
We're giving them the tax relief.
It could be up to 9 years.
If they apply for the other piece,
yeah, which
they aren't at this
point. They haven't applied for that other part of it yet.
It's nice to see a place in town as historic as that being taken on. So
I am just thrilled. You know, I had walked through it with the EDC. We were looking at trying to save it. It was in rough shape, and to have somebody come in and be able to save that and redo it is, I think, a real plus for our town. So I'll make a motion to approve and sign the decision RE application of Wolfeboro Property Holdings for tax relief incentives under RSA 79-E.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Next, we have the presentation of the warrant articles for the videotape program. Everyone's gotten the packet of the what we're going to be showing tomorrow. Are there any, you want to go through these all, or we want to just talk about, is there any discussion on any of these in particular?
I think we know that Brad's not going to be there tomorrow, so I think we need to divvy up some of his things, and I'll be glad to take a couple of them that are pretty simple. The capital reserve account M, I'll be glad to do, and the other one I'll do was P.
I'm sorry, Dave, which ones are you doing?
M.
M.
And P.
And I'm willing to do the Center Street. I have the other edition, which has the numbers, so I'll do Article 10.
What was the other one?
It's Article 10. It's the Center Street project.
Yeah.
It says I'll take that one.
No other ones are left.
More Capital Reserve, Public Works. That's what I'm going to do.
And there's, he only had three that I could see. Yep. How many do you have counted for him?
I have 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, that's all I could find. I think the other one is that we probably need to make a comment about the citizens' petition. I don't know who wants to do that.
Yes, Mr. Harriman had asked me to develop a statement that he would read. And actually, town council has given me some language for that statement, mm-hmm. and I have that here in my book, but I haven't put it together as in one piece of paper yet to hand to whoever's going to read it, but I can read to you the essence of it.
I also put something together when I talked to the chamber, kind of took his two key sentences and thought that pretty well made the statement we needed to make.
Town Council advises that the warrant article proposes a number of procedures, such as requiring investigation by an outside agency that towns have no legal authority to implement. And then he suggested that a statement that the Board of Selectmen has an obligation to place a petition article on the warrant, even if we believe the article is improper or illegal.
Yeah, that's what I had. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's perfect.
I can read that tomorrow.
Okay.
Mr. Owen, did you get any new pages for this, for our presentation?
Pages?
Yes, pages. Did we get, I had sent to Mr. Yeah. Ford and asking whether we would get any more pictures, and
yes,
I also talked to the...
Those changes have been made.
Okay. Will we get an updated, because it's going to be hard for us to know what's going on if we don't have, I mean, I know that the fire department had worked on some new slides also.
Yes, those have been incorporated also. And Matt sent me a copy, an electronic copy of the revisions this afternoon. I looked them over. I found one error, which I asked him to correct. And so I think it's all set. I can send those out electronically.
Perfect.
When I'll go downstairs.
Electronically is fine, because I'll just print the pages I need. I'm not going to reprint this whole.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
Thank you.
Next, we have reconsideration of the special election to fill the vacant state representative position. Board members, I'm going to allow some general public commentary.
I would like to see that happen, that we let public make comments at this point.
Is there anyone from the general public like to make a statement?
I'm John White, Wolfeboro, live on Pine Hill Road. You all know me as the town Democratic chairman. I'm not here tonight as a chairman or a Democrat. I'm here as an American who thinks suppression of a special election, even for economic reasons, is a very bad idea. If the very essence of government is equal representation and free elections. State law provides that approximately 3,000 citizens each shall have a representative in the House. Wolfeboro is entitled to two. With the resignation of one, of Mr. Parker, to take a better position in the government, we are down to one. Now, everybody else in every town will have one representative for 3,000 people. We will have one for six. That is not fair. It is not lawful. I believe it is incumbent upon the board to reconsider that vote and to schedule a special election. We're talking very little money, $3,000 or $4,000, I am told. We could shake the cushions at City Hall and probably come up with that. We could have a bake sale and make that kind of money. But the money isn't the issue. The issue is the representation, the continuance of government. By saying you would not have the special election for reasons of economics is to put a price on the Democratic Republic. It's nothing special, really, the special election. We have three, four, five, sometimes six representatives resign every biennium. Every other town does it. I have petitioned the governor to declare a vacancy and ask for a special election. If the governor declares a vacancy and asks for a special election, we may have to petition the court to get a special election, but we will get a special election. I would put the question to you this way. Which will cost you more money? A special election or a lawsuit to defend suppression of the election and then the subsequent election? I and a lot of citizens in this town feel very strongly about this. Now, I must add that yes, as a Democrat, I would live in high hope that we would have a Democrat win this election. But that's not why I'm here tonight. Wolfeboro Democrats live in high hope with very low expectations. The next Democrat who wins from Wolfeboro a seat in the House will be the first. And it is very likely that we'll have the special election, it will be another Republican. But so what? He may be somebody we can talk to. He'll be a neighbor, or she'll be a neighbor. And that's all we want. A neighbor, a fellow citizen in Concord to represent us as the law requires. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Blair Moffitt. I live in Wolfeboro. I don't want to repeat what John has eloquently said, but just to put it this way, a democracy is not the most efficient way to run a country. If you want efficiency, then we need a dictator or a king. But we have defended for over 200 years the right of the people to choose their leaders. And the whole American enterprise was begun over the issue of taxation without representation. Yes, it's too bad when it costs us extra money, and it's too bad when it's messy and crowds the schedule. But these freedoms, these rights, these privileges are precious to us. And I would argue that it's important for us to take the extra steps necessary to make sure that our way of life and our way of government is preserved. And I urge you to support a special election. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else in the audience?
Hi, Joe McDonald. I think it's my first time in 55 years to come before the Board of Selectmen. The reason I came in is I support the special election also, but there was one other time back in 1999 when my dad died that the seat wasn't filled. I just want to bring that to everyone's attention. And I don't think it's going to be as easy as this gentleman very eloquent spoke about. From my research, it looks like we'll have to go to the governor and council. They'll set the date, and then if there's more than two people running as Republican or Democrat, there'll have to be a primary. So that'll be one other process. And then after that will be the election itself. But again, I support the special election, but I'll support your authority in making the determination. Thank you.
Thank you.
Claude Rossiger, Wolfeboro. I hadn't intended to say anything, but John's words were so eloquent that I would simply second them. Thank you.
Anyone else?
I'm Edie Damaris, and I live in Wolfeboro. And I would just like to second what our friends have said. I think it's as an example to our children and to the people, the young people in this community, we're trying to get into our democracy and to learn how it works. And I think it's a valuable lesson, and I think it's worth the effort for our representation and also to set an example. Thank you.
I'm Lynn Slocum. I had not intended to speak either, but I would like to, you know, support what John and Blair have said. And one point that I that keeps reoccurring to me is, if this had happened later in the term. It may be valid to question the cost of the special election. But since this is at the very beginning of a term, and we essentially have 2 years left in this term without full representation, I feel that you really need to reconsider your previous decision and reverse it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
In addition, Mr. Chairman, the board received a letter in the mail today on this subject, which you haven't seen yet, so I'll pass that around. And I also received another phone call on the same issue today, all in support of the special election.
You think we should read this?
You may. You mean read it into the record?
I can read it into the record. It's from William R. Connors, 24 Robin Acres, Wolfeboro, Board of Selectmen, Honorable Selectmen. And an unfortunate aspect of American politics is that elected officials often fail to complete their terms of office, whether it is a function of ambition, lack of commitment to the position to which they have been sworn, or simply a political structure that is designed in a way that leads candidates for higher office to abandon their positions midterm to seek higher office. It is a fact of life. We have seen it quite recently in Wolfeboro, when a selectman ran for higher office very shortly after being elected to the board. In this election year, we've had seen numerous senators and governors largely abandon their duties to campaign for the presidency. As a voter, I have long been disappointed in what, in many cases, I perceive as disloyalty to the electorate. Mr. Parker's decision to resign from his position just weeks after being elected is unfortunate, and the potential expense associated with an election to replace him is irritating from my point of view as a taxpayer. I share the board's frustration with the expense of a special election, however, it is a part of politics. And what is more disturbing is the notion that citizens of the town of Wolfeboro would be denied appropriate representation in the House of Representatives. While I commend the board's fiscal responsibility in resisting this anticipated expense, I believe that it is critical that the residents afforded their very basic right to choose their representatives. And that right is not abrogated by elected officials, whether for political, financial, or any other reasons, however noble they may be. I respectfully request that you reconsider your position on this matter, and I thank you for your attention. Really, truly yours, William R. Connors. Board members?
Can I make a comment? Just because the people that spoke, who I respect, were not here then, I just should mention what happened, so you don't think the Board of Selectmen voted against you, which was not true. Pat Waterman sent us a notice that to do this would cost an unspecified number of thousands of dollars, and that would also disrupt things in a way, which is fine. Harold Parker was here, and he said that that he is on the Governor's Council. He said he's from Wolfeboro, keeps an eye on Wolfeboro, and will continue to keep an eye on Wolfeboro, and he felt that having a special election was not necessary. So the board, and no one spoke up from the public at the time, unlike tonight, so the board went along with it. So that's just the background of what happened for those who weren't here.
When we had that discussion, I had said at that particular time that I was uncomfortable with our decision not to hold the election. I've had calls from many people. I have talked to individuals, and I believe that we should hold this special election. I think it's important that the town does have that representation down in Concord and also in the county level. So my support is for us changing our decision to reconsider and to hold this election. Okay. I'm being asked to make that as a motion. I'll move that we reconsider and we hold an election for the vacancy in the state representative. I don't know where we are now in terms of dates. The document I have says we'd have to go to the council on January 18th. I'm don't know if what you did will do that for us. So I don't know the dates. I can't put a set date to my motion.
We'll write a letter to the governor's council tomorrow and see when they can take it up.
Okay. So I make the motion that we hold that special election for the representative seat.
I'll second that.
The motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion from the board? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you for coming.
Next, we have proposed amendments to the personnel policy.
Mr. Owen? Yes, Mr. Chairman. Given the some of the changes that were granted to the two unions as far as different levels of benefits, I thought we probably wanted to provide a level playing field with the union, the non-union employees. So I've made some revisions. They're the ones in red ink on your copies of the personnel policy. Also, we changed the reference to the pay and classification study on page 3. And made some other changes to reflect changes in the health insurance offerings. One of the school care products that we had the school care point of service plan, the POS plan, is no longer going to be provided. They're doing away with it. So there's no need to have reference to it in the document. So I've gone through and made those revisions.
You don't have to leave, you know.
And unless the board has any other changes or questions, I would request your approval.
Looked good to me. I checked it out. Seemed like you had everything. I'll make a motion to approve the proposed revisions to the town personnel policy.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do we have any old business?
Well, I don't know whether it's old business or any other business, and I don't know where the board really would want to deal with this, but we have received a petition from the non-union department heads, and I didn't know where. I think we need to talk about it. I don't know where you want to talk about it.
This is a great time.
Okay. What we received was a letter to us. There was concern on the non-union employees expressed by the department head that they were only getting a 1.5% raise, where the union representatives were receiving a 3% raise. And I have gotten some explanations from Dave, and I think it would be good, you know, for us to talk about that and the range and how he explains. I'm not quite sure how 3%, they got 3%, and maybe you can help us out on this a little bit, Dave.
Yeah, I think the letter that you received reflects a misunderstanding, which I apparently contributed to by not fully explaining this at the department heads meeting. When asked what the unions were getting, I said approximately 3%. So I think there's some people are assuming that everybody in the unions got 3%. Well, they're not. As you saw in the information I sent out, the AFSCME employees are receiving anywhere from 1.15% up to a maximum of the top of the range is 8.27%. And that depends on whether their position was reclassified to a higher rated position or not, and also the pay scales for the different grades of positions, the minimums and the maximums changed. So this, the union settlements represent the implementation of the pay and classification study that we went through, and not everybody is receiving 3%. That's just sort of the average. I take partial responsibility for not adequately explaining that when that came up last week.
I saw an email earlier, it was later on in the day, but I think another good point was, maybe you can reiterate it, but it was a point about looking back over the last couple years and...
Yes, I provided some information looking at the last 10 years of history between what the unions got as the basic wage or salary increase and what the non-union personnel got. And basically, I think what it shows is that there's years when the union's done better, and there's years when the non-union personnel have done better. In fact, there's a few years back there, 2008 and 9, when the unions got zero, while the non-union employees were getting very hefty increases, like 3.5 and 4% increases, because the unions were fussing about the health insurance changes we wanted to make back then, and they wouldn't settle. So I think, all in all, I think, you know, there's a rough comparability between the two different groups, the union employees and the non-union employees, and that some years one group may do better than others, but overall, if you look over the last 10 years, I think both groups have done pretty well.
I think also, Luke, you need to look at with the new wage study, there was also a whole new step program implemented. I think there's now 13 steps.
Well, for AFSCME, there's now 18 steps. We went from a 12-step pay plan to 18
That's
steps.
A big change. Sure.
So the step increases will be much smaller in the future.
Right.
I guess my concern here, and I went back into our non-public minutes. I know that we made the 1.5 decision based on the consumer price index that we looked at. We did that in October, and that, I don't know if anybody else, but I kind of forgot about that as they went out to negotiate the different contracts, and I'm not part of the negotiation. I see what come back. I understood what came back. But what concerns me here, it seems like we have some employees who feel undervalued, not appreciated, and being treated differently. And I think we have to address that. And I think we need to try to figure out what is the best way to solve that. Is it the best way to give them more of a raise? Is the best way to do a better explanation? But I think we have to do something. I don't think it's a good idea to have a bunch of employees feeling the way I think they're feeling by putting this out. And I don't know what the other members of the board might like to do, or whether Mr. Owen has any suggestions on what we might want to do. To give them a 3% raise is around $31,000. That's what our choices are, but I think we need to do something.
Well, I think a better explanation would help. because I think what they're expressing here is based on a misunderstanding or misinformation or lack of information.
Yeah, the way I feel is, you know, I definitely think that goes a long way to, you know, a better understanding of, you know, what the numbers actually are. If they were able to see that, I do agree with Linda's point. We don't want our department heads, our employees, to be thinking they're undervalued, because they do the work of the town, and it's important that, you know, that we continue to show that they are valued what they do.
I mean, we count on all their reports and to give us the information to make the decisions for the community. I had kept on asking Mr. Owen for more information. We talked to this list that he got was something he and I had talked about. I was upset when I was at the public hearing in front of the budget committee, and Pat Waterman came up and said there was this discrepancy. That's what started me. Mr. Owen and I had a conversation about it and trying to make me understand, and I agreed where and understood where the changes were, you know, and then this came out after that. That's why I asked Mr. Owen to put down where we had been with those different departments and between union and non-union. I thought they had been closer over the years. I think if a better explanation would take care of it, that would probably be the best, but I'm not sure once things get going whether that will be. But I'm concerned.
Well, I take a motion, or what do we want to do here? Dave? Well, we could go with the 3%, or we could just go back and give them an explanation and see, but we're running out of time, too.
Well, I think if the town manager says it's a department misunderstanding, the first thing to do, I think, would be to straighten out the misunderstanding rather than saying we don't recognize that at all and here it is. I mean, I'm not saying we shouldn't do it, but I would think that maybe an explanation would be necessary just to settle any discomfort that we actually care, and that and let David Owen, let town manager explain that, and then have them come back with a proposal maybe after the explanation.
Well, I think part of the explanation that came in here that it was the Board of Selectmen who had done this, and I wonder whether we shouldn't write a letter to them with the explanation. I think it needs to come from us. I was initially going to come in and say, okay, you know, I want to add $31,000 to the budget, and then I was busy all day, and at the end of the day, I had a chance to kind of look at what we had done. And I guess my first choice at this particular time was to get them to really understand what that implementation, and I went also to look that the following year the unions only get a 1% and a step increase. So, but I would like the letter to come from us. Dave can do it, and if they need one of us to come to a meeting, I'm more than willing to do that too. But I just think it needs to come from us.
Okay, I'll be glad.
I think it should come from the town manager, because he's the one that said that there was some misinformation. Otherwise, I don't think it's good for this. I mean, I'm not saying I don't endorse it, but I would think that maybe if David Owen sent a letter and then we approved of the letter or something, then we're not saying, David, we're just going over your head. I mean, just lines of responsibility.
This is what he wrote. This is what's in there. Pat Waterman questioned why the non-union was only receiving a 1.5%, and Mr. Owen stated it was the Board of Selectmen's decision for the non-union. That's why I think it needs to come from us, because that's, again, their understanding of where this came from. And I think we want to give them the fuller explanation. I don't have any problem if the Board of Selectmen and the town manager sign it. But I think because of the way this is written, we should respond.
I'll be glad to draft something for the board's consideration and signature.
You said what? I'd be in favor of that.
Okay.
But I think it should also, David, as you had said, you should also take it back quite a few years and show...
I'm fine with that, yeah.
Yeah, I'll do
who
that.
Who got what and when, and I mean, there may, some of these employees that signed this have been here a while, so they shouldn't, well, we do forget sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, Dave.
They need to be reminded as far as what's happened in the past as well. I think that should be part of the...
Okay.
Out of the formula.
I'll attach that.
Yep.
Any other old business? Any other business?
Yeah, I have a and some other business. I have been going to the Fisherville meetings. We were so excited when the snow came and we could just see that snowmobile path coming down and that lake was going to freeze and then all of a sudden it opened back up. So what the Fisherville committee would like to do is to plan to do the Brewfest in the dockside parking lot as the main plan, and then if the ice freezes, to get the bob houses out on the lake, not too far from the dock, and kind of make that the center. And if by any chance it gets to be that we can put everything out on the ice, we will do that. They will be applying for a liquor license and a permit for us to hold that event. It will be February 11th. They're asking the Board of Selectmen for permission to close the parking lot and permission to start bringing the bob houses down to that area on around February 6th.
Let me tell you a motion.
I will make a motion that we do that, close the parking lot, dockside parking lot, on February 11th, and we allow them to start bringing the bob houses down on February 6th.
I'll second that.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Aye. I always am on a roll here. The other thing I think that it's about time for us to do, we usually once a year or twice a year go back and look at our non-public minutes and then release the non-public minutes that we can, and I think it's about time that we do that. So I would like to suggest that we do it at our next meeting.
Okay, we'll arrange that.
That's all I have.
Okay. Town manager's report?
Just a few extra things I wanted to report out. One, today I received the resignation of Jeff McGinnis from our Economic Development Committee. He's leaving Huggins Hospital, so he'll no longer be able to represent the hospital and the EDC. Also, I wanted to report that the equipment operator position in the highway division's been filled. That was the vacancy that was created when we had somebody leave about a month ago, all of a sudden. And so the new equipment operator is Brian Williams, and he has worked for the DPW as a temporary employee and a seasonal employee, so they're familiar with his work, and he's been trying to catch on full time with the town, so it works out well for both parties. Also, we received a written confirmation from Primex last week that they're going to be paying for the repair of the gold facing, gold leaf on the clock tower clocks, the hands, and the numerals. And that's with the exception of a $1,000 deductible that the town will have to pay. So. And the fellow that actually does the repair, Mr. Devanza, has been in touch to say that he plans to remove the clock faces in April, and he'll do the work, I guess, in his own shop, and then bring them back and have them reinstalled in time for Memorial Day. So there's going to be a month or so that we're going to have
blanks.
did
the electric company help him get those out? How do we get those out?
They're going to bring a crane and
crane. They're going to bring a crane. Okay. Yeah.
That'll be part of the repair.
Okay.
Repair cost. And the final thing I wanted to broach with the board is about the town warrant. We have to post the town warrant by January 30th. And the board has to have a brief meeting to approve it and sign it. Unfortunately, we don't have it for you this evening because the planning board just had their public hearing on the zoning articles last night, so we haven't got it all compiled yet. So I was wondering if the board might be amenable to a brief meeting next week, possibly Wednesday. Not Wednesday, another day?
Well, I won't be here, David.
When do you get back?
What number day is it?
February 2nd.
Oh, forget that.
You guys can sign.
Yeah. And when are you leaving? Oh, you can't sign before. We can't leave. Okay.
So you'll be gone all week?
We'll be back on the 2nd.
We could try to get something together by Friday afternoon if you wanted to.
Well, you'll have four signatures probably anyways.
Yeah. Well, it depends.
Well, Brad will be available, I'm sure.
Right. Well, I was going to propose next Wednesday, the 25th.
I'm okay if we do it at, 6:30. It's a chamber social I usually go to.
Oh, yes. I have that on my calendar also.
You know.
I was thinking maybe like 4:30 or something, so we could go to the chamber social afterwards.
4:30 on the 25th.
4:30, I'm okay at 4:30.
Sounds like there's agreement on that.
Mm-hmm.
4:30.
Thank you. I get the wrong.
It'll just be the one item to approve and sign the
4:30
warrant.
Okay. On the 25th.
Okay.
Okay. Oh. You lucky guy.
Yeah, it isn't always that way when I'm down.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Committee reports.
I went to the Economic Development Committee. I saw Matt Sullivan in action for the first time in at length and was very impressed with his knowledge of state, local, and other regulations and his hands-on whatever. The Economic Development Committee has had some problems with the public understanding what the EDC is doing. So we're going to figure out something under Kathy Eaton to have a public conference, a sort of a public seminar where people can come and express to the EDC, which is a division of the Board of Selectmen, their concerns, their pleasures, their problems, and help the EDC understand what the general public would like, in addition to the people we normally talk with. This is being worked out and would probably be in a month or two. End of comment.
Well, we wrapped up budget, Mr. Owen and I wrapped up budget committee last week, so my nights are free again.
You done? I went to the EDC as an alternate, and that group is definitely well-organized and moving right along. We did a summary of last night in Wolfeboro today, so the special events committee met. We're going to start meeting once a month to try to pull the things we need together, fundraising and looking at different kind of events for next year. We figured we'd meet now, and then in the summer we wouldn't meet and then start again in the fall. I have been to a Fisherville committee meeting. I went to the budget committee public hearing, and I was disappointed that there was not a member from the public there. I really wish we could get more people out to those meetings. I had a doc committee meeting earlier last week, and I'd like to also point out, this is my new thing, what's going on at Abenaki and Park and Rec. On January 21st, 2017, there's the Abenaki Ski-a-thon that's helped to raise money for Abenaki Ski Lodge, and I think they're trying to raise some money to finish the outside of the storage hut. That's at 4 p.m., and then there's going to be a Christmas bonfire at 5. On January 28th, there's going to be a crop pot competition and a cross-country ski event at 6. I went over there this weekend with my 2 4-year-old boys and grandsons, not my boys, my grandsons, with their parents, and they went on the kiddie slope, and it is fantastic that there is a little tow rope that these four-year-olds can hold onto, so you don't have to push them up the hill so they can come down. And we had lunch in the new lodge. The meal was more than reasonable, and the place was crowded, so what a gem we have. And so I will be giving you our winter carnival events each week. That's all I have.
Thank you.
I went to a Zoning Board of Adjustment meeting. That's all I have.
You did the DOC committee?
That's right. DOC committee, too, which is actually going along very well. We had a meeting with the captain and owner of the Mount Washington, and he was extremely enthusiastic about what we're trying to do with the docks. So that was a big feather. Now I have to pick up some plans from Jim Rines, which will, next meeting, I think he and David and I think we're going to go to the Wolfeboro Inn, explain to them what was going on. So that'll be our next step on that DOC committee. But yeah, everything is looking very well as far as, you know, for the future on that.
Is there any more talk about moving the buoys out for the?
Yes, that was discussed as well. There will be 2 buoys this summer that will be placed out there at 150 feet off the docks.
I thought there was only going to be one.
Did
we say two?
Yeah.
Mount Washington was excited.
My recollection was one.
One?
One, yeah. I think there was only one. I thought it was
anyway,
one.
There will be a new buoy out there.
Okay.
But the Mount Washington cluster that's there now will be moved out about 30 feet so that the mount will come in almost directly into their slip, or their berth, and that will allow us to extend the docks to wherever we want to extend them to, in essence. So they were really enthusiastic about that whole thing. And that way they can back out, you know, as they go out to their right and then out of the bay. So yeah, that was quite a surprise to us as a group, how enthusiastic they were. And they said that they would supply whatever was necessary at the state level to help us.
Great. Questions from the press?
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, public input limited to 3 minutes per resident, not to exceed 15 minutes in total.
Claude Russinger, Wolfeboro. Thank you. You will remember that the last time I came before you, I asked the board to identify when it had voted to authorize the alteration of the scenic roads of Wolfeboro. I met with Mr. Harriman, Mr. Owen, before Christmas, at which meeting they told me that no such vote could be found. This was not particularly surprising to me. Also, there was no public vote upon the matter. Now, the RSA 238.1 based on the advice I have from counsel and upon a plain reading of it, suggests that one or the other had to occur for the alteration of the roads. Either the board had to authorize it, or the people had to authorize it. This not having occurred, it would seem that the alteration is contrary to law. This creates a problem, and it's the problem that I've been discussing with you for a protracted period. Jonathan Hopewell, an old Wolfeboro family, came. The road in front of his house, so that we don't discuss repair and maintenance, which has been thrown out, has in sections been doubled in width. That is surely alteration. I have also checked the definition of repair and maintenance. It is the keeping of an existing condition or its restoration. It specifically provides that it is not improvement or alteration. So, where does this leave us? It leaves us with work that has been done, according to Mr. Owen, without a plan, without a budget, and with no record of the work, but accounting for hundreds of hours of machine time and labor. Curious that there's no record, no plan, no consultation with the residents. But even more curious that it's done without authorization. So I came to you with three questions the last time. I come to you with 1.5 questions this time. My question is, what do you propose as a reasonable solution to what appears to be work done contrary to law? And I would say to you, as I've already spoken to Mr. Harriman and Mr. Owen, that there's no desire to be unreasonable here, just to have a reasonable, serious discussion that leads to a serious resolution so that we can stop this. That leads me to a second question, which is a part, but I do want to ask you this. You know that I've lived my adult life in Wolfeboro. You know that I built the largest private employer on this side of the lake. You know that I've been involved in town affairs. Some people agreed with me on SB2, some did not, but I undertook it because I believed in it. Does any one of you think that I am less than serious in the work I do? Or that I'm fooling around or playing games? I ask you.
No, I don't think you're fooling around, and I don't think you're playing games.
Thank you. Welcome. I would be grateful to you as a board if you would have a word with our public works director and share that opinion with him, who has written that he feels I'm playing games. I am most assuredly not playing games. And it vexes me to read that as it would you. Now, back to the question. I've probably exhausted my 3 minutes, so I'm going to step down. I would appreciate a response, because we have alteration of roads, unauthorized. What shall we do? And again, perfectly willing to be reasonable. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other residents? I'll entertain a motion
motion to adjourn?
Yes.
So I'll make that motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?